Good morning, church. How is everybody today? Great to have you with us today in the context that you are with us, whether you're here in the building or elsewhere. Can we pan the camera out so everybody can look back at the center camera behind them and wave hello? What a world we live in. You can go to church without going to church. It's amazing, isn't it? How's your fantasy football team doing? Awesome. Great. Cool. Well, if we haven't met yet, I have really lame jokes, and my name is Kane McEntire. I'm the youth director as well as the visitation director here for West Heights. Been here for just a little over a year, and what a wonderful year it has been. So it's great to have you with us in worship. I have a few things that I want to bring to your attention before we continue in worship together. First off, the ushers are going to be coming forward now with baskets, and the baskets do not have snacks, unfortunately. I tried that, but it didn't work out. But rather, Connie and Curtis, they have attendance pads instead. Now, if you're a person that would like to write that you were here today with us on paper, that's great. That's what the pads are for. There's also a QR code in those attendance pads that you can simply scan with your mobile device, usually your camera app. Most smartphones nowadays will have a QR scanner in it. If not, you might need a QR scanner app. And that will take you to a basic webpage where you can fill in the same information in a digital sense, and that all goes to us as well. We don't share that information with anybody else. We keep it in-house, make sure we have great ways to reach out to you and contact you about all the ways that you can connect here in the life of West Heights United Methodist Church. Beyond that, I also just real quick, I want to say thank you so much to everybody who participated in the golf tournament yesterday. Don't have any figures or updates for you on that other than we just simply want to say thank you to those that sponsored, those that participated. Those that also were volunteers. If you played a part in any way, shape, or form in the golf tournament yesterday, could you simply stand so we could recognize you? Can we give them a hand, please? So by standing, if anybody ever has any questions about their golf swing, they know how to ask now, right? Ann Murray. I just sponsored a hole. Oh, you sponsored a hole. Okay, all right. Last but not least, I'm going to ask a good friend to come forward to be recognized as well before we continue in worship. Dave Glover, would you please come up here, please? Didn't know you were coming on stage 2 weeks in a row, did you? So, that's true, but you don't have to sit down this time. Okay. And I'm not going to ask you any questions either, so there's that. But no, we want to recognize Dave Glover. It was announced this last week. I don't know all the different channels. I saw it on Facebook that Dave Glover was recognized as the Volunteer of the Year for Family Promise of Greater Wichita. And so we just want to recognize Dave for that tremendous work. Nice. I know if I did ask you, you would also like credit the team and people like that. And you actually talked to me before the service today and told me that we're gearing up for another Family Promise Host Week.
We are. Yep.
And that you have some volunteer needs.
Yep.
And so I just want to encourage anybody that hasn't participated in Family Promise in the past, or maybe you have and you would like to get back into involvement and making a difference in the lives of others in a pivotal time of their life, to please consider helping out with the Family Promise Host Week this coming week. What week is that?
20th through the 27th.
October 20th through the 27th. And you have a few different volunteer needs specifically that you mentioned to me earlier, and I wrote them down. And the first one is that we specifically need people that will come in the evening time and spend time with the families before they tuck it in and call it a night by, you know, playing games, hanging out, having some conversation, things like that. And then secondly, you need people that will stay overnight as well with the families to make sure that they have their needs met during that overnight time. You get to sleep. I'll bring melatonin if you need it. I don't know what else it would be. So that's what I take. I mean, and stuff. That's my nightcap nowadays at this age. Yeah. And then and things. And so we have, it's a wonderful opportunity to make the difference in the lives of others. Thank you, Dave, for your work and your effort in that. And please get involved in Family Promise if you haven't before. Can we give Dave another hand? With that being said, will you stand as you are able and join us in our opening hymn? This is O God, Our Help in Ages Past from the United Methodist Hymnal, page 117.
You may be seated. Good morning. I'm Pete Jacobs, and I will be your reader today. Please join me in our call to worship. Jesus said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me."
In Jesus Christ.
Jesus said with blessed assurance, "In my Father's house there are many dwelling places."
Dwelling places prepared for us, children of God. Jesus promised, "If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you there myself, so that where I am, there you may be also."
We give thanks for the promise that when it is time for us to leave our earthly lives, Jesus carries us home to be with God. Our first reading comes from Ecclesiastes 3:1-2. For everything there is a season, and a time for every matter under heaven. A time to be born, a time to die. A time to plant, and a time to pluck up what is planted. This is the word of God for the people of God.
As we move into this time of prayer, I want to start as an invitational, but also there's, I have a lot of people over the years that go, just don't make me do evangelism. Right? Y'all with me on this? Okay. The evangelism team is usually one of the hardest ones to fill, and here's the reason why. People think I'm going to put a bullhorn in their hand and put them on the corner. Okay? I'll just be honest with you. It doesn't work. What does really work is if you're going to volunteer for Family Promise, for you to be praying about somebody you could invite to join you. Not necessarily from the pews beside you. And just asking God to point out, who is this person? How may I invite them? Because so often, walking into a building like this is scary as all get out. Because you don't know what they're going to, which version of the Lord's Prayer are they going to do? Which, am I going to know anyone? Am I going to walk in and, you know, sit down when I'm supposed to stand up, or vice versa? And so being very clear with what their first engagement's going to be, like, hey, you're going to come, you're going to join me and play in some game with some kids and help fight homelessness in Wichita. Every part of that is pretty clear. And so being in prayer and just saying, God, who in my life might I be able to extend that invitation for, allows us to nurture. And so often people are wanting to make a difference. And they may not be connected to a church. They may not be connected to an organization that gives them that opportunity. And so quite literally, there are people out there praying that someone like you says, hey, would you join me in this opportunity to serve our community and God? So I used to think there's a bunch of people out there ready to yell at me when I ask that. But what I have found over the years is even if someone was opposed to the idea of church, they had had church trauma or whatnot, that when we go into that conversation, I said, oh, no, I totally understand that. I just wondered if you wanted to help me serve food to these folks who are trying to help, we're helping out of homelessness. And 9 times out of 10, they go, that sounds like something I would definitely participate in. So it's not a matter, we're not asking when we talk about evangelism for you to go, have you been washed in the blood? Nah, I mean, there may have been a time and place for that, but relational, caring, loving invitations, those are the ones that say, let me be a part of making the world a better place. So I just want to invite you to take that kind of radical chance. And the other way is always leave the door open for a follow-up. So if they go, that's really not my thing, go, okay, well, if you ever change your mind or you're interested, you know where to find me. It's that simple. Graceful, loving, smooth. You can even practice on your cat or dog before you go talk to the person. I say that, we all kind of did a laugh, but if you practice saying it out loud, it makes it a lot easier not to stumble on the words when they come out. So, as we continue in this time of prayer, maybe this is one of this first part of silence is where you hold that person in your mind. Who would you like to invite to help make a difference in our community? If you're struggling today, maybe let that be the thing. So just openly lay it before. Imagine your heart is opening to God. And in that space, allow peace to become a part of you, okay? So we'll take a few breaths. I'll lead us in a pastoral prayer and the Lord's Prayer. We will sing this time, just as we have. So thank you last week for reminding me, Valerie. Don't let me go through it again. Let us start with a couple of breaths. Good morning, God. We gather together in praise and thanksgiving for your grace and your love. We prepare this week to welcome our unhoused neighbors. We prepare this week to bless these folks. Guide us and lead us in those moments of preparation. Guide us and lead us in those spaces of offering love and hope and care. Guide us, God, as we draw closer to you. But Lord, sometimes as we come to worship, we're still very much frustrated by the realities of life around us. Maybe it's a health concern. Maybe it's an old injury or a bad back. Or maybe you just woke up on the wrong side of the bed. God, so often we think our troubles are too small to lift up. They're too petty or normal or regular, and we don't want to bother you. But remind us that we can read the smallest of complaints along with the greatest of fears in the book of Psalms, the holy book of songs of the ancient church. So if they would sing that, we too can offer our truths to you. Hear us now, God, as we pray as your son Jesus taught us so many years ago, saying, if you would join me in our prayer hymn, Word of God Speak.
Our second reading comes from John 14, 1 through 4. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may also be. And you know the way to the place where I am going. This is the word of the Lord, word of God for the people of God.
Will the children come forward for children's time?
Cute. Oh my gosh, you guys have to see Penny's outfit. It's so cute. Okay. Hi guys, how are we today? Yeah. So today we're having an interesting service. We're talking about life and then also death. And so for children's time, I had to think in my brain, what were we going to talk about? But I think we have something good today. Now, I'm going to show you guys this. What is this? The Holy Bible. This is a Bible. This is a Bible. Penny, this is a Bible. It's a Bible. What's in this Bible?
Words and also these verses and John's and German's and
okay. So there's verses and words and everything. What does this particular book talk about? Parts of it, yeah? Jesus. He said Jesus. So but God, yeah? Okay, so when we put something in a book, what's the purpose of that, you think? People to learn about it. So when all the disciples were writing all their stories, and when all of the prophets were writing down all of this stuff that goes in this book, do you suppose that they felt like whatever they put in here was worth remembering? Yeah? Yeah, it's worth remembering. And so I think that says a lot. And as I was thinking this week on what we were going to discuss, you know, there's lots of people in this book that we have to remember, right? And they've all come before us. They've all come, everyone in this book has come before us, except maybe God. He's kind of still, I guess, there. I don't know how to describe God except that he's never gone, right? He's always there. But all the people within this book, we have to read about them. We have to learn about them. We have to tell the stories about them. We have to remember them. Because if we didn't remember them, would we know them? Okay, so Gatsby, I know you know who this is in this picture, but I'm going to show everybody a picture today. Don't say who it is right away. This is a very important picture for me. Okay, who is this?
It's our papa.
This is a picture of Gatsby's papa, or my dad. And we're getting close in our church year to a day called All Saints Day. And on All Saints Day, what we do is we remember the people that have passed away in the church for the year. Now, every All Saints Day, I remember your papa, or John, my dad, because he passed away 14 years ago. But what's the important thing that I always share with you, Gatsby, about your papa?
Yeah.
And you know about him because I do what?
remind me of him?
I remind you of him. I tell the stories, right? So when someone in your life passes away or you lose someone, and maybe some of you children have and maybe some of you haven't, but when you lose someone, I think the most important thing that the Bible teaches us is that we have to remember them, right? And so if that happens or when that happens, because we all end up losing someone at some point, what I want you all to remember is to remember to tell their stories. Remember the things that they did while they were here. Remember them. And if maybe someone in your life is already gone, like your papa, and you never got to meet them, ask your family, ask friends that knew them to tell you the stories so that you can know them in your heart, right? Because sometimes that's the only way we can know someone. That's how we have to know Jesus, is in our hearts and in our minds and in our souls. And we have to know that what was put in this book was worth remembering, okay? All right, we're going to say a quick prayer. And then when we get to All Saints Day, when you guys are here for All Saints Day, I want you to remember that story about remembering people. And that might make it a little bit more important to you, okay? All right, you might want to. Sorry. All right, so this is a repeat after me prayer. Dear Jesus, help me remember you and your wonderful, awesome, and amazing life. Also help me remember the stories of those around me. In your name we pray. Amen.
Hello again. Everybody alive out there? Well, that's good. Hey, I just want to welcome real quick, if you'd help me, Deacon Joey Hickey to the stage. Would you all make her feel welcome today? All right. We are here for a conversation on death and dying. I've heard that there's two guarantees in life, death and taxes. So with that being said, I had a question about my 2023 return. Could you help me? No, thank you, Joey, for being here today. I really appreciate it. Joey is a friend of Pastor Jacob's, and I was mutually introduced to Joey by Jacob. We met a couple weeks ago in the evening at Milk Float. Had a great Pop-Tart, would highly recommend it if you haven't been there before. And had a great conversation there as well. We're blessed to have you with us today. And
tried to say no.
And you tried to say no? Yeah. I don't know if it's going to heed our request or not, but that's okay. We'll just. All right, there we go. Perfect. Okay. So with that being said, would you just maybe introduce yourself a little bit to us today, where you do your ministry work at, what that looks like for you?
Well, I'm Joanne Hickey, and I work for Home Health and Hospice of Kansas right here in Wichita. Before that, I did a lot of training to become a chaplain in three different hospitals, and I worked in places that were level one trauma centers where people with really serious injuries could be brought, and people of all ages. And I was, after we sat and chatted at Milk Float, and later I was thinking about how, well, working at hospice, sure, I work with people who are really severely sick and probably gonna die, but sometimes get better and get discharged. But also, working at the hospital really gave me a lot of experience with people losing their loved ones and people facing death and having to make decisions about what they want for their medical care. So, yeah. Now, also, I'd just like to share that I am friends with Pastor Jacob, and the way I met him was I love coffee, and he used to work in Lawrence, Kansas, and that's where I lived. And this annoying United Methodist was always hanging out at my coffee shop. And I was really done with the United Methodist Church. I didn't want any part of it for my own reasons. And Jacob, I don't even know how it, he kept showing up on my Facebook feed with his new church. And I was like, what is, and so finally I said to him, I guess we have mutual friends. Because even though I wasn't a Methodist anymore, I had grown up a United Methodist youth, and I have a bunch of friends who are pastors and leaders in the United Methodist Church. And so we got to talking about who our mutual friends were. And then one day, Jacob says to me, hey, Joey, I know you went to seminary and you're interested in the Bible, and what about this passage? And, or it might not have gone exactly that way, but he says, yep, that was it. And we started talking about the Bible all the time and talking about the upcoming lectionary, and he just wormed his way right into my heart. And before I knew it, I was back in seminary, finishing seminary, and so thankful for the witness and evangelism of Jacob. So when he was talking about evangelism earlier, I was just like, oh yeah, I know how that works.
Yeah.
And then there's one more story that I want to tell you before we get to your questions.
Yeah, by all means.
When we sang, Oh God, Our Help in Ages Past, I teared up a bit. Because when I was a high school youth, I had a pastor who made a huge impression on me, G. Marie Gravier. And I can remember short little G. Marie standing up in the front of the church singing, Oh God, Our Help in Ages Past, with zeal and happiness. And she passed away within the last several months. And I didn't get to go to the funeral because of various circumstances. But so that losing someone, loving someone, mm-hmm. having things that make you remember them, whether, and being in a Methodist church and singing, it was kind of cool. It's pretty cool. So
thank you.
There you have it.
Yeah. All right. Well, my first question for you today is, what is the most profound lesson that you've learned from ministering to people or with people who are facing the end of their life?
Well, I brought a poem that talks about, I wrote this one before I was a hospice chaplain, but when I'd been hanging around in the hospital. It's called Mountaintop. When my time approaches, let me go to the hills, perhaps a cabin perched on a ridge in the Smokies, where I can feel the mist on my cheeks and hear birds singing in the dawn, a big porch with room to lie down if needed, and a driveway with room for vehicles of family and friends. As day dawns and dusk comes, so it should be for me, the natural movement from arrival to departure. Save me from medical interventions and tubes carrying things in or out, or God forbid, violent chest compressions forcing circulation past its time. I will stay organic. Thank you for asking. There's so much to enjoy. I will strive to savor each day. I will not hang on at the end wishing I had enjoyed things sooner. Tell me a joke or sing me a song. Whisper a prayer and hold my hand tight. Enjoy everything right in the moment. Let the sun set and await the new dawn.
Thank you. How has working with the dying shaped or changed your personal understanding of life and death?
I think things that have changed my personal understanding of life and death are losing someone suddenly. My dad died when I was 7. One morning he had a heart attack in the living room, and we didn't get to say goodbye. And he didn't get to see me grow up. Another thing that shapes my view of life and death, maybe from working in hospice but knowing people, is that I had this experience. One of my friends, after we were talking on the phone, and after I'd been working in hospice a few months, and I said something about a patient, and she said, "Well, your patients are all dying." And I said, "Oh, no, they're living." And she said, "What?" And I said, "They're living. They're living maybe even more fully. They're not giving up. They're not stopping. They're not dying before they're ready. They're living their lives. They're doing what they can, enjoying the things that they do. And they're happy to tell me stories about all kind of things that have happened to them." So we don't die before we die. Even if, and you know, sometimes you know you're going to die and you have time, or you just know, hey, like I got a patient who's 100 and she doesn't have any specific thing wrong with her right now that we know, but she's 100. So, you know, she knows the end is closer than the beginning. But I also think about you and what you said to me when we met. You said, "I had this mile marker birthday, and I thought, oh, I'm probably more than halfway done." So, yeah, I remember turning 25, and I was going around saying, "Hey, I'm starting the second half of my second decade." And then I did the math, and I went, 0 to 10 was my first decade. Mm-hmm. So I'm already in my third decade, and I felt suddenly worried. Oh, no, time is going by. So.
Yeah, I turned 40 a couple of years ago, and turning 40, it was kind of like, I've always been like an average person and like a statistics and numbers driven person all the way till I was young, until I was like a small child. And so one of the first things I did when I turned 40 was, what's the average like lifespan of a man in America? And I saw like that 76 number and was like, right? and things. I love your emphasis though on people that we might, you know, approach as their time is coming to a close, still being living, still reminiscing, reeling through years, going through that experience in real time while there's still life within them.
Oh, and enjoying things.
Yes.
Enjoying their favorite candy or their favorite, yeah.
Yeah. I'm going out to a Bruce Springsteen song if I have any say in the matter, because I want to go out enjoying something.
So. One of my seminary professors, when he was, they were playing, I forgot that. They were playing hard rock music.
Oh, yeah.
In the ICU for him, because that was his thing.
Perfect. Within the ministry and the work that you are working, that you are operating within and functioning within, surely you are in contact with people that are from, that have difference between each other. So like different ethnicities, perhaps different religious or spiritual backgrounds, different affiliations, connections and things like that. So with that in mind, are there any noted similarities in how people shape their approach to death with respect to those noted differences?
Well, one of my CPE instructors, which that's clinical pastoral education, which you might have heard of because most Methodist ministers are required to go do CPE. She told us, and she had worked in hospice for a long time and then got certified to be a CPE educator. She's a very wise and amazing woman, and sometimes reminded me of Jean Marie. She told us, if you've seen one death, you've seen one death. And what she meant by that was everybody's different, everybody's unique, and you can't really generalize. Mm-hmm. I mean, you can say, you know, we're generally born with two legs and two arms and two eyes. But as soon as you start trying to generalize, then all of a sudden you're like, well, but this one guy did such and such. Oh, and you remember Mrs. Harrington or Mrs. whoever. She did this.
Yeah. How do you help patients and families find meaning or peace as they navigate a dying process or a journey?
Well, they're the ones that are looking for meaning and peace, or they may not be. they might just be looking for a drink of water or a way to get through the night or some hope for tomorrow. So what I do in my work is I come and be with you, maybe tightly hold your hand, maybe sit quietly. Maybe somebody's angry and they need someone to yell at, especially in the hospital setting. Chaplains can fulfill that duty very well. Because, you know, you don't really want to yell at the nurse or the doctor who you've got to rely on for your health. But some chaplain from some denomination you've never heard of comes wandering in your room. And maybe you could just unload some of that. But what I do, you know, when those things happen, it can be hard. But what I do is, before I enter a room or a home or a space, I say a prayer to entrust that person to God's care and that whole family. And when I leave that place, I remind myself with another prayer to entrust them to God. I think that always remembering that I don't carry them, I don't take their hurt and their pain or even their hope, because it's theirs, and those are their feelings and their ideas and their experience. And if you try to take somebody else's life and carry it along on their behalf, it only works for a little while. So respecting them to find their way is really important.
Yeah. I also like your emphasis on providing a place for them to depressurize in a safe manner. Yeah. May not want to depressurize towards your doctor directly because, you know, the doctor still has to care for you, right?
Yeah.
So you are currently amongst people that are living, yes? If so, we should stop the service right now. And I do funerals. No, I'm just kidding. All right. What advice do you offer to us this morning? Many of us are anxious to some degree or another about our own death or the death of a loved one. What kind of advice or wisdom would you offer to us?
Well, of course, I mean, it's almost trite, but it's actually a practice I do, is tell people that you love them now. Tell them when you hang up the phone. Tell them when you see them. Just give them a big smile. Whatever way you do that, loving, don't wait. Don't wait, don't wait, don't wait. We've been reading the Holy Scripture today from John 14 that reminds us of our belief in eternal life as Christians. I think that's the most comforting thing, especially families who have a belief in eternal life. I talk to people every day who are looking forward to that, who are happy about that. This morning I was watching CBS mornings while I was getting dressed, and Shirley MacLaine was being interviewed. She's 90, can you believe that? And her hair was all white, she didn't have it. And I don't know if you know, she wrote a book years ago about her beliefs, which are not necessarily Christian, but they're about contacting people from the other side. And the commentator said to her, he asked her a question about death and made reference to her beliefs, and she said, "Oh, I just am so excited to find out what is on the other side. I can't wait to experience that spiritual realm." And there's really no reason we can't be the same as Shirley MacLaine.
All right. Well, what have you learned from your work that you think could help us live more full lives while we still have them?
Well, I don't know that I've learned that from work. I've probably learned that in coffee shops and on mountaintops.
Sure.
And holding my kids or seeing my granddaughters. Or praying. There's times in the car when I'm really having to say that prayer three times. God, I entrust my patient to you, when it's harder. Yesterday I did a funeral for one of my patients. You know, they say we're not supposed to have favorites, but how would that be? How could you do that? I mean, this guy, he, like Jacob, just wormed his way into my heart. So those are the things I think. What about you? You've done, I think that's a good question for a pastor.
Oh. Anybody want to hear me preach? No, I'm just kidding. What have I learned from what I do, my life experience, that could help people live more fully while they're still here? I'm going to borrow a little bit from one of my favorite singer-songwriters. I learn a lot of theology and concepts of life from music. And his name is Jason Isbell. The song's called If We Were Vampires. And the concept of the song is that if we were to live forever within the concept of love, however we understand love to be, and just dwell in that for an infinite amount of time, it wouldn't matter as much to us as it does, because the temporary aspect of it is what makes it the gift, is what makes it important, what makes it necessary, needed, vital to life, love in the context in which we understand it. And so I try to become a person that's more assured by the fact that what I have, what I get to enjoy, what God has blessed me with, what I'm privileged by, is temporary in the sense that it will shift at some point in the future by death. And it's that temporariness, and I don't know if that's a word or not, but it is now as far as I'm concerned, is what makes it valuable, is what makes it a treasure. And so that's my concept and my understanding, is being thankful for the temporary aspect of it so that I could be grateful for how important the people are and the opportunities in my life that I have.
The limited time.
Yeah, yeah, the limited time only thing, the limited edition aspect, I guess you could say.
So can we go off script and off book and ask people to tell the person next to them what makes their life meaningful?
I love that.
Okay, so here's your assignment. And let it get noisy in here. Tell a person next to you or behind you, or just close your eyes and whisper it in your mind if you're as much an introvert as me. What is it that what made yesterday special, or what makes your life special? So you can be, and I'll set my timer. You got 2 minutes.
I love this. You have 2 minutes and we'll reconvene in 2 minutes.
Starting now.
This is awesome. I love that.
He left me up here.
Thank you.
Well, thank you for that moment and for that opportunity. I hope that was a blessing for you too. And Joanne, thank you so much for being here, and thanks again. Can we give her a round of applause? Greatly appreciate you taking time to talk to us about a subject matter that is meaningful, applies to all of us. And with that being said, if the ushers will come forward to collect our tithes and offering, and I'll be right back. Thanks again, Joanne. Please rise as you're able.
Thank you.
please join me in our prayer of dedication. Loving and eternal God, we come before you, humbled by the mystery of life and death. You are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, and in your hands we trust our lives and our deaths. As we reflect on the fragility of our days, remind us that our hope is anchored in your eternal promises. When we face uncertainty, may we feel your comforting presence. When grief surrounds us, may your peace that passes all understanding guard our hearts. Give us the grace to release our fears and entrust our loved ones and ourselves into your care. May we live each day in the light of eternity, filled with love, compassion, and a deep sense of your abiding presence. We offer these gifts, as well as those unseen, to your purpose and love. Amen. Please join us in our closing hymn. Announcements to share before we close our service out. First one is that Wednesday, October 30th is our annual fall festival, trunk or treat, Halloween-ish type event. We need your candy donations. And so if you would like to purchase some bags of candy, that would be greatly appreciated. Maybe look out for some good deals on some of that bulk candy. Please don't drop it off in my office if you expect to make it to the event, because otherwise I will eat it. But if you bring it to the front desk, bring it in with you as you come to the church, that would be greatly appreciated. We also have the musical review coming up on November 8th, and I believe that's a Friday evening, and tickets are for sale out in the foyer during worship. You can also purchase those in other contexts and times by seeing Gabby or someone else that knows what they're talking about, which isn't me. And the Arts and Crafts Fair is coming up on Saturday, November 9th. Last but not least, out in the foyer as well, we have a few different resources based on the conversation that we had today in our sermon time. The first one is from the Kansas Methodist Foundation. This is a book called To My Loved Ones, and what it is it's a guide to planning your funeral and your final affairs. And so this is something that was built, that's being provided through the work of the church and the congregational care ministry here at the church, that could kind of just help you plan ahead in a proactive sense. And then also, Joanne brought some flyers from the home, or brochures from the Home Health and Hospice of Kansas. And so they will be available at the same table as well. I think I got through all the different announcements, and that might be worth a round of applause in and of itself, but that's okay. Let us go through, receive this benediction. As we continue about our lives, as we have them, may we go about, may you go about your days, walking in the essence of the love of God for yourself and living out that love of God for the benefit and the sake of others. Amen? Amen. Go in peace and have a great day.